Welcome to the Tree of Life podcast. My name is Joel Letford, and today I have the privilege of being here with Dr. Philipp Zerbe. Philipp, welcome.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
So one of the things that we always start out with is getting an idea of your background. So I'm really interested to know, how did you end up at UC Davis? What was your pathway to get here? Where did you do your undergraduate training? What got you interested in science?
So my path to UC Davis really is geographically a little long one. I did my undergrad in Germany and my PhD, and then moved to Canada for some time doing research there, and eventually ended up here 5 years ago. Outside of that, I think in terms of how I got interested, it really started early, I think. I didn't know that myself. Actually, when I started my job here, my parents sent me a little note that I had written apparently when I was six. And it says, I want to be a biologist and I want to drive a Porsche. So I'm a biologist. I don't drive a Porsche. But apparently it started very early. And what I think my parents and a lot of the teachers throughout the time really nurtured that sort of initial interest. I was always into the science books, learning about how things work. And I think in university really kicked off. What I learned, sort of sitting the first lectures and meeting scientists at the University of Germany, was how complex molecular life is within and outside of plants, and how many questions there are, and what all we do not understand, that really captivated me and sort of.
So when did you write that note?
Apparently when I was six. I mean, I have no recollection of it, but when they sent it to me when I took my job here, I mean, it was just really eye-opening. It's like, wow, I guess there was something there that really motivated me all those years.
Yeah, I think that's great. You had already this maybe starting to see yourself as a scientist. There's this, you know, there's a lot of research actually that has been surrounded by this ideas of what scientists are and what they look like, especially in public education for the past, I think, 30 years or so. Middle school students have been asked to draw a scientist.
Interesting.
And people have been keeping these drawings and sort of figuring out, you know, who they're drawing, how are students identifying. And a lot of students, you know, in the past 15 years or so, you know, most of those scientists are sort of the stereotypical Einstein, you know, white guy as a scientist. But it's been slowly changing, and it's actually been really cool to see how people's perceptions of scientists have changed. But I think it's great that you, even when you're six, start to identify yourself as a scientist. And it's I'm curious to know, you know, so in how do you characterize the differences in terms of your education and experience in Germany as opposed to here? What do you see are the key differences?
It's almost two sides of the same coin, right? Like being a high school student and an undergrad in Germany, the system has a lot of rigor. Right, it's a very school-like system. There, at least in my time, it also in Europe, it has changed over the years. It was very clear what you had to do every semester. There wasn't really a lot of options outside of that, and there was no demand on doing anything else but studying hard. So it makes for a very strong education. You get a lot of knowledge transferred. You really become very good at theory behind everything. In contrast here, I'm not saying sort of it's less rigor, but it's somewhat more flexible. There's more self-determination in what you would like to specialize. There's more opportunity, but also demand on doing extracurricular work, whatever that might be. And so I think maybe I came out of my undergrad a little bit stronger theorist and a stronger scientific background, but certainly less prepared for life.
Okay, that's interesting.
So it's a more holistic training that I see here, and I very enjoy it now as an instructor. To be able to provide those opportunities is fantastic.
That's great. Well, so today I wanted to talk to you and ask you some questions about your research. And you know, I want to start off asking questions that are a little bit more broad. And so in introductory biology here, we often talk about primary and secondary metabolites and metabolism. And I wonder if you could just briefly distinguish primary and secondary metabolites for us.
I can try. I mean, first thing I should say, between those two, there's a lot of gray zones. It's not a black or white distinction. In primary metabolism, these are usually metabolites, so small molecule chemicals that an organism truly needs, essential for its survival. So this has to do with the growth of an organism or its reproduction. You could think of sugars, you can think of hormones, those kind of chemicals. If you turn it around to the secondary, or now we sort of like to call them specialized metabolites, these are, it's not that they're not essential, but an organism, if it is perfectly happy in its environment, would at that moment not need them. These are now chemicals that are often used by an organism to communicate with other organisms or with its environment, right? So you can think of chemicals that attract a predator, or chemicals that are used to suppress the growth of other plants around you, sort of, that give you an advantage in the environment to survive.
So, you're a plant biologist, at least plant-focused, and so if I am thinking about a primary metabolite in a plant, I'm thinking about chemicals that are necessary for that plant to grow and survive. But a secondary metabolite might be some of those things that sort of deter herbivores. So maybe some of the stronger smelling kinds of things that people have used, for example, culturally as perfumes or things like that. I mean, when I think of the strong scent of pine trees, would you consider that to be a secondary metabolite or something like that?
Yeah, absolutely. That would be a perfect example. And these are really fine-tuned, honed, essentially words in a dictionary that plants use to communicate with the environment. So in the smell that you mentioned in pine trees, it's called piney, and it's one of the really strong smelling compounds that it is used in the fragrance industry. Surprisingly, it's actually also used in the biofuel industry. You can make really effective jet fuel out of this.
Wow.
Which is fascinating to think about what all kind of applications you could think of from these naturally produced kind of chemicals.
So one of the secondary metabolites that really stands out to me is Taxol from Pacific Yew. I mean, I've spent a lot of time in the Pacific Northwest. I've seen yew trees and little mini groves of yew trees, and I know that they're not terribly common. I don't know the abundance of Taxol that they produce, but I do know that when it was discovered, there was sort of this rush of how are we going to possibly grow enough yew trees sustainably to get the Taxol that we need. And so I guess that dovetails a little bit with what you do. And so how does that process work? How are we going to go from probably lower abundance secondary metabolites in something like a yew tree to something that's actually sustainable and usable on a large scale?
It's a fantastic question, and it's very much under development. Right? So Taxol, for those who haven't heard about it, it is a specialized metabolite. It's a very complex one at that. It is used in chemotherapy, so hopefully not too many will have been exposed to it or loved ones, but it's a very potent drug that impact cell cycle, so it can stop cancer cells from growing. Now in yew tree, it's found in the bark. That's, as far as we know, one of the very few natural producers of this compound. And you're very correct. I don't know the exact number, but in order to have one dose of Taxol for one patient, you would need dozens of trees.
Wow.
So you can easily imagine that this is not a sustainable resource. Taxol was identified in a chemical screen in the 1950s. And since then, there have been many approaches on trying to find sustainable ways. The early and still continuing work is chemical synthesis. It's a very complex molecule, so this is not easy. It is very expensive to do. So with sort of the advent of synthetic biology and biology really developing new tools, people are starting to think about alternate ways on how we could achieve this goal. Currently, the largest tool to make Taxol, it's a company up in Vancouver in Canada, among others, they're using cell cultures. So not a tree anymore, but you take the needles of the tree and you turn them into a tissue culture. And that can be used to produce Taxol without decimating the tree populations. So this is used right now, but there are big questions about how can we do it more targeted. And so enzymes come into play, right? Now we have all these fantastic tools on understanding how chemicals are made, what are the genes, what are the enzymes that are making those in the tree. And so we currently have a project on trying to do this. It's a very complex biosynthetic pathway. It requires at least 19 enzymes to make Taxol. And even though it was discovered in the 1950s, only a handful of them are actually known yet. So we're still missing a large part of this. And so our idea here is, and not just ours, and many people out in the field that are trying to do this and trying to contribute to the field, is can we go back into the tree, understand how the tree makes this compound, meaning find the genes and the encoded enzymes that make this compound in the yew tree, and can we move this into another organism to make it sustainably? This could be yeast, this could be another plant, bacteria, all the many things that we can use to ferment or produce these natural products. And so there is a lot of activity in this field to try and achieve this goal.
Wow, so in general, if I guess maybe Taxol is somewhat of an exception because it is so complex, but if I'm interested in a secondary metabolite and I want to produce it synthetically, then really the first step is to characterize the enzymes that are involved in the pathway of its development and then try to engineer that somehow synthetically into a more model type of organism like yeast. Is that fair to say?
That's fair to say, exactly.
And so I guess another question that I would ask is that I know that you've been looking at some secondary metabolites in things like maize and rice. So I'm assuming that those are a little bit less complex.
I shouldn't say sadly. No, they're not. Surprisingly, even though maize and rice are such common plants to us, their chemistry is amazingly complex. And given how long they've been around and how long people have studied them, we still barely scratch the surface of what they're truly capable of in terms of producing bioactive chemicals. So in maize, for example, we've been studying this in collaboration with Eric Schmelzes and Alisa Hufaker's group in San Diego. We find that maize actually produces a large number of really complex metabolites, specifically in its roots, which we just didn't know before. And so this is really fascinating, and they're complex, they're very bioactive, they're actually antibiotics.
Oh, okay.
So what they do, from what we understand so far, is that they're likely involved in helping the plant defend itself against microbial diseases, much like we would take antibiotics if we catch a microbial disease. The plants do that too. And so we're trying to understand how does maize produce these, why, and what is it doing? Right? And it's very intricate. And as a scientist, there's really a lifetime of understanding to be done. Because we see if we increase a dosage, like we would do with a human antibiotic, these are very potent. If we only use very little, we actually see that it seems to also have a role in attracting other microbes, maybe microbes that help the plant grow. We know that plants assemble microbes around their roots to provide them with nutrients, to really help them to adapt to the environment. And it seems that if you're under this toxic level of these compounds, they have a different kind of role. So these interactions and the communication between plants and environment is just amazingly intricate. And I mean, every day shows me how little we understand it. It's fascinating.
Wow. So I mean, ecologically, that's really interesting, because maybe ordinarily you might think, oh, let's just enhance the expression of these. But, you know, in reality, maybe there's a little bit more of a dynamic system there to, you know, establish the root microbiome of something like maize, and then later on to prevent bacterial infection. That's really interesting. Yeah.
And I think it shows us a very important lesson, and that's that really detailed understanding before we start tinkering with that defense. I mean, this has established itself over millions of years of evolution. It's ongoing in the plant, but to think about engineering it is very fascinating, and I think it's a very important goal, but that detailed understanding of what all actually this will impact in the ecological environment is critical.
Yeah, that's great. I love that, bringing it back to the organism.
Yeah.
So even though you're looking at that small scale, the organism really is, it's important to keep in focus.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much for coming on today. I appreciate you answering all the questions, and we definitely look forward to hearing about what your lab does in the future.
Great, thank you so much for having me.
Thank you.
Thanks for watching our video. If you enjoyed the content but would like an audio-only version, please go to iTunes and look up Tree of Life UC Davis. If you want to see more videos on YouTube, please click the subscribe button, and don't forget to hit the little bell icon if you want to receive notifications of new content.